Good evening to you and welcome to this program of Walter and Grounding. I'm your host, Dion Abrams. And with me again this week is Dr. David Hine. And together we'll be talking about current issues in the political landscape of Guyana. Welcome to Walter and Grounding, Dr. Hine.
Well, thank you very much, Dion.
Before we get into our discourse, I want to simply tell the people of Buxton, Friendship, and the other areas within the Buxton Falls NDC that are flooded that all efforts are being made to relieve the situation. I think Buxton is experiencing the most severe flooding conditions right now. And that is precisely because two of the cokers still up at the Crown Dam that would release water into the village from the conservancy area. Those cokers were left open. What I'm understanding is that some of the villagers, when they go up there to hunt and so on, they would open those cokers and leave them open. But we were able to get the guys to go up there and to shut them off. And possibly, well, soon we're going to chain them off so that people cannot go on it. Open up those cokers. Apart from that, there is a breach in the company dam between the company canal and the sideline. So water from the high-level company canal is flowing into the Buxton west east sideline, and that is compounding the situation a bit. But I'm hoping that the NDIA will get machinery down there because it has to be called, you know, to and then be filled up so that the water stops flowing over the dam. This breach has to be sealed. But an additional pump was placed at the seawall, one that is pumping from the canals into the basin itself. And then you have, well, when I was there this morning, the tide was in, so the sluice could not be opened, but the pump on the wall itself that was throwing the water over, that was still operational. While the old pump that we had there since 1927, that was at full go, pumping into the basin, and then the other one. So two pumps were filling the basin, so that as soon as the tide goes out, the water will be released into the Atlantic. What we have to do is to pray that the rain doesn't continue. So maybe within the next 2 days or so, that the water can be off the land and people can begin to feel at ease. But efforts are being made to ensure that the situation is brought under control. Right? I'm pretty pleased with Georgetown because what we've noticed is that unlike previous years, even though the water may be on the land, within a jiffy, it's down. And that is precisely because of the work that would have been put in the city to ensure that all the canals were cleared, the debris that would have been there, you know, all that stuff that used to be in those drainage canals would have been removed. And one person remarked that a pleasant thing about the flooding in Georgetown now is that even though the water is there, all that rubbish that used to take over the streets and the land and everything, that these things are no longer. So the unpleasantness of that is something that we have to be grateful for. Buxton still have to, we still have to get some of that going. I must compliment Mr. Andy Neptune for taking the initiative to pull all this stuff out of the Middlewalk Canal. Near him, there all the food boxes and all of that. And if more people within the community can take that kind of initiative, and not only in Buxton, but right through, because one of the things that you find is that all that stuff, particularly the canal separating Fowles from Enmore, between Enmore and Fowles, people throw all kinds of stuff in there. So at the railway embankment, the bridge is kind of low in relation to the canal, so the water is just up there, and everything comes, and it's a sight all across. So we need to take more care about dumping. The people who are dumping the stuff on the seawall, all those bags of chicken feathers and guts and all of these things, we need to really be more concerned about what we do with our environment, all right? Because it's not only the NDC that has to take the responsibility to keep the environment clean, citizens also have a role to play.
Let me ask you this, Leon. Shortly after the government changed last year, there was this massive public-spirited cleanup, and people were staying away from throwing boxes and all that thing around. What has happened?
I think the mood, the euphoria and everything, I know in Georgetown, a lot of that still exists. If people find you throwing things, there was a time when you throw stuff out of a minibus or so, the guys would make you pick it up and that kind of thing. Some of that is still happening, but I think along the coast and so on, a lot of that kind of spirit has been lost. All right, so people need to keep that consciousness, and we have to remind them that the environment is a responsibility not only for the people who have to come and pick up the stuff, the NDC and so on, but they too have a responsibility. Mm-hmm. And I was speaking with my cousin and good friend this morning. He's he has a master's in environmental health. And he was telling me, because where they're throwing all that stuff is right next to the water treatment plant.
Hmm.
And he was saying that, you know, I mean, leaching is bound to take place, and that stuff will eventually go down and get to the water table. And so we are basically harming ourselves when we do these things. Throwing all that filth around where we have to get our water, even though the water is underground, when the rain falls and all of that. So we have to be more conscious about what we do and the effects it can cause on the immediate environment, but the long-term effects that it can cause on the entire community.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so, but if I am saying that, I've asked the people in the area there, once they see people dumping stuff, because it's easy to have a photograph now with a cell phone and so on, take their photographs and so, and we're going to prosecute them, all right? Because they can't have them doing that,
mm-hmm.
all right? And unless you begin to enforce, you know, then people are going to believe that they can continue to do these
mm-hmm.
things, all right? So people are definitely going to end up before the court if they persist with that kind of stuff. There are limitations. The NDC has only one tractor, all right, which doesn't have a large capacity, all right? And then we pay Sivons $128,000 a week, all right, to clear the bins. And but that is through the entire NDC. One truck, you know, two times per week is basically a drop in the ocean. Okay, so it's a challenge, but we still have to be responsible in terms of how we treat with the garbage mm-hmm. and so that we have. All right, so we're working on the flooding, and we're hoping that you, the people in the community, can help to keep your environment clean and not to encumber the parapets and so on. All right, stick within the parameters of the law. Right, so last week we talked about a number of things, but we promised to look a bit at constitutional reform this week. What are your particular concerns in relation to the constitution and reform
mm-hmm.
that are needed?
But clearly, I mean, 50 years after independence,
mm-hmm.
there's time to renew our republic. The last time the constitution was changed must have been about 20 years ago, or thereabouts,
mm-hmm.
when there was some limited constitutional reform. The had done this extensive consultation, but after the consultation, it was left to the political parties in Parliament to determine what would go into the Constitution. And of course, political parties are concerned with power and so forth, and they were reluctant to go far enough. For example, as I remember it, one of the major calls from people all over the country was to move towards a kind of power-sharing arrangement. And neither of the two parties at the time went in that direction. And we may have lost a golden opportunity to push the country further away from the brink of political and ethnic brinksmanship. This time around, the process was kick-started by a committee headed by Nigel Hughes, who met with a number of individuals and perhaps groups to hear from them about their concerns and what they would like to see as part of that reform. I myself was invited before that committee, and there were some eminent people on the committee. Apart from Nigel, you had Professor Joe Pollard, Professor Lochman, the late Haslin Paris, and I may be forgetting a couple of names. So we had a committee that was well placed to deal with such a matter and to make recommendations. Since then, the recommendations coming out of that committee was given to the Prime Minister, who has a responsibility for constitutional reform in the government. And the Prime Minister, I notice in this year's budget that there are monies that are allocated for that process. However, my own sense is that there is not enthusiasm on both sides of the political aisle for constitutional reform. I think there's a commitment on the part of the government, and I think that they're going to carry out that commitment. But constitutional reform calls for a commitment. It calls for it's a very tedious thing. If you look at the rest of the Caribbean, take a place like Grenada, for example. Recently, they had a referendum on constitutional reform. They were trying to make some small changes to the constitution to bring in term limits, to ensure that there is always an opposition, because you know, Grenada has this thing where the ruling party has all the seats in parliament. Okay. All right. And they also put on the ballot the CCJ. Because, as you know, a number of the countries in the Caribbean
want to join
well, they have not joined, and they're trying now to get to join. And that whole initiative was defeated. It was defeated, not even the CCJ was passed, right? And it was defeated because of two things. One, there was not partisanship. And secondly, our people are not in the habit of voting in large numbers outside of elections. And so there was a turnout of 28%, I think, at that election. But more than that, it started bipartisan, but then the opposition party wanted proportional representation to be part of the change, because okay. They are first past the post, and they wanted to replace that with proportional representation, which we have. Mm-hmm. The governing party did not want that, so the opposition party left the table. What it meant, what that meant was that the constitutional proposals were seen in partisan terms. And so the opposition supporters
stayed away,
they did not support it, they vote against, and so on and so forth. So we have this issue there where constitutional reform becomes part of the partisan agenda. And here in Guyana, we have got to be very careful about that. So that the ruling coalition of parties are pushing constitutional reform. But I don't think the constitutional reform will go anywhere unless there's a bipartisan approach. This is the lesson of Grenada. In fact, we can go as far back as the breakup of the Federation in 1962, when the Jamaican Labour Party mobilized against Federation, while the People's National Party mobilized for Federation, and the people voted on partisan terms, and really, in a sense, broke the dream of the Caribbean, what it would have been
If the Federation had survived today, we would have probably been living in a federated Caribbean state in which we would have been economically stronger and so on and so forth, all the benefits that come with that. So I would think that the first lesson is that we have to find a way to begin the process in a bipartisan way. Now, having said that, bipartisanship in Guyana is perhaps the most difficult thing in the world after Donald Trump.
Okay.
because the opposition party smells blood. It feels that it can win the election in 2020. And so it is not concerned with cooperating with this government on anything. And
it,
that's the tragedy.
That's the American experience.
Exactly.
Also.
And that's the tragedy here. So the government will be pressured to push ahead with constitutional reform. But if it does so and the PPP is not at the table, then in the end, we are going to be undermining ourselves.
But the whole question of the PPP and its attitude to reform, I mean, they've never been a reformist party.
Mm-hmm.
Because we've noticed that even during their tenure, that even though Parliament would have passed the local government bills, you know, the procurement commission, the bill for the procurement commission and all of these things, that they were never implemented. So what it was basically a cosmetic thing that, look, we are moving towards these things, but implementation was not really part of their agenda. Now, you were saying that currently their attitude is that we can win and we don't really need to be part of this process. Is this a new approach by the PPP? I mean, your relationship with the PPP going back to the PCD days, is this a new PPP or is it the
No,
same?
And even before the PCD, if we go right back to the 1960s,
mm-hmm.
When Kwayana in 1961 came out with joint premiership and called on Mr. Jagan and Dr. Jagan and Mr. Burnham to come together in a power-sharing government with a kind of joint premiership.
Mm-hmm.
And it was rejected by both of the parties. But when the PPP saw that power was slipping away from it in 1963, it came to the table with its own proposals for power sharing, by which time the PNC had seen its path to power and it turned its back on that. We also saw that the PPP, again, when in 1977 it realized, well, the PNC has entrenched itself in power,
yeah.
It then came out with the National Patriotic Front government. And again in 1985, this time on the initiative of the PNC, the PPP came for power sharing. What is not well known is that in 1990, when we were supposed to have had new elections, but because of Jimmy Carter's intervention, elections could not be held on time, the WPA proposed in the PCD that the PCD approach Mr. Hoyt for the formation of a government of national unity to run the country until elections can be organized. And the PPP, again, sensing that it could win, told the WPA, no, it wouldn't go along. But the WPA could go and talk to the PNC. When the WPA went and talked to Mr. Hoyt and the PNC readily agreed. And the PPP said no. So they turned their back once again on a government of national unity. Of course, we know when they came to power in 1992, they did not even want a government of unity with the WPA and their other allies in the opposition. So this is a party of domination, right? And they make no bones about it. In fact, Dr. Henry Jeffrey, who served as a minister under them, has popularized that thesis, if you will, of the PPP's politics of domination. And who better to know than one who has lived in the house. And so therefore, as a party of domination, it does not come to the table for national unity and cooperation if it doesn't think that all is lost. If one follows that premise, perhaps the PPP will have to lose the next election before it begins to realize that the answer is national unity, by which time minds would become hardened on the other side, because politics is give and take. Because people on this side will say, well, when we were willing to cooperate, you were playing hard to get. And now you are, your back is against the wall, you want to come in. So that kind of politics has really dogged us for almost 60 years. And one of the unfortunate things about the PPP is that more than even Dr. Jagan, at least Dr. Jagan would come to the table, he would, you know, he would give warnings that he would like to cooperate with him. This PPP, at this particular juncture, is concerned about power for the PPP and the PPP alone. It therefore puts the government in a bind. What do they do? You can't have far-reaching constitutional reform without the vote of the PPP. There are some things you may be able to change with a majority in parliament. With a lot of the entrenched laws, you need a two-thirds majority, or you probably will have to call a referendum. And in both cases, you will need the support of the PPP. And I don't see the PPP going in that direction. I'm saying all of that to say that constitutional reform is in trouble. It cannot be done by the government alone. And if the government decides it will go alone, despite the reality of the situation, what we are likely to see is a partisan defeat of the idea. When you defeat constitutional reform, it's difficult, really difficult
to get it back on
board. Mm-hmm. And so this is it. I mean, you see in Antigua, for example, who once stole a referendum on the CCJ, after they saw what happened in Grenada, they've decided to postpone it because they don't want to risk defeat. And that's where we are in terms of constitutional reform. But we badly need some degree of constitutional reform, certainly at the level of electoral politics, certainly at the level of the composition of government. I continue to believe that power sharing is the answer to, at least in the short term, to some of the problems that dog us. We talked a little while ago, and probably we'll talk about, you know, oil coming to Guyana. But our oil economy is not going to benefit us if we don't have a national approach to development. And I would think that constitutional reform is central to that.
Okay, so the nature of our government is high on the agenda.
Yes.
Is that government at the national level or at the local level?
Well, I'm very glad you raised the question of the local level. A few years ago, I talked about what I call horizontal power sharing at the top and then vertical power sharing between the top and the bottom. My own sense is that I think that local government needs to be deepened. We used to have local government right down to the village level. And then we replaced that with the NDC and the RDC and so forth. I think those structures are inadequate to deal with local government issues. You yourself would see that when you're dealing with the NDC. And so therefore, one of the things that I would prefer, and I think Vincent Alexander spoke about that, is the return to the village councillors. That is to return local government closer to the people. See, local government makes sense the closer it is to the people. The NDC is not as close to the people as it, because the NDC is a group of villages come together. But what the village council does is that it takes it another level. So one is not saying to abolish the neighborhood democratic councils, but in addition to that, to create another level of local government that is closer to the people. It means therefore that that people can have direct responsibility over what happened with drainage in their communities, for example. I think that's a critical area. What happens to the lands in your community? The decentralization of agriculture. Education, to some extent, can be determined at that level and so on and so forth. So there's a really dire need. And most importantly, certainly for African villages, which are ancestral villages and ancestral lands. And the taking away of local control over ancestral land. So you take a village like Denhamsdale or a village like Anne's Grove or Buxton. These are villages that were bought by the people, the foreparents, it belonged to them. You now take those villages, which are what? The birthright of the people, and you put them in a larger neighborhood council. So you remove ownership of lands and resources from people whose foreparents bought those lands. So the return to the village council is really return to ownership and the birthright of people who bought those villages. So that's very important. I also believe that there should be a second house of parliament, a second house. That is, we should have
a bicameral
legislature. And that legislature should include representatives from the local authorities. Right? So that in that legislature, I would want to see members of the Regional Democratic Council, the village councillors, and so on, having representatives there. Certainly things like the non-governmental organization, the churches, women's groups, youth groups, and so on, being part of that second house in the legislature. And that house should have a veto of the low house. Right? In England, there is something, the House of Lords can hold up a bill for 6 months. They don't have the final say, but they can hold it and send it back to the lower house. And I think I favor something like that, where you have people's organizations and people's representatives from their communities who are in that house, which serves as a counter to the party representatives. And so there is a way of ensuring. Now, of course, I want more autonomy for local government, especially in the area of finance. Because the NDC still has to depend on the RDC for money, and the RDC still has to depend on central government for money. So down at the bottom there, if people don't pay their taxes, and you would know that they don't pay much tax. I pay mine yesterday.
Okay.
I'm current. Right? But you know people don't pay taxes. So therefore, without taxes and with a little freck coming from the central government, you can't do much in terms of development, in terms of dealing with simple things like flooding and the removal and things. So I would like to see much more autonomy for the local government, both at the village level, the NDC level, and the regional democratic level, to be able to have more independence. They should have their own budget, and they should have more independence in terms of what they do with that budget. Of course, there should be oversight, right? But I want more. I don't think you can talk about local government reform if the local government still has to rely on central government for monies and other forms of financing.
But in terms of bringing local government home, some people may argue that because of the new system where you have the PR component and the first past the post component in the local government system, and that would answer the question of making local government closer to the people. Is that really so?
Not necessarily, because you see at elections people vote for party. Mm-hmm. Right? If you're in the village, you're voting for villagers
who are in the party.
Villagers who, whether they're in the party or not, will have to, and that is the culture we have to return. We have to make a separation between party and people for their competence. Now, you're WPA, but I don't think that people voted for you as chairman of the Buxton Falls NDC because you're WPA. They voted for you because you had a track record of community service and activism in the village, and I think that is the way it has to be. Now, you see, if you belong to big parties, PNC and PPP, you tend to push the party and people respond to you as party. If you belong to a party like the WPA that is not one of the big parties, you have the advantage of people judging you based on your work and your activism. And I think that is something that we have got to begin to teach in the schools, that there is something called civic responsibility. Okay. There is something called community responsibility as distinct from responsibility to political party. You see, once we get rid of civics and we get rid of the nation and loyalty to the nation, it means the political party becomes the only institution. You could go to them for a job, you could go to them for this, you could go to them for that. So people identify with them. But if we put back in place local authorities, village authorities, and even within the villages, people have to be in wards and so forth, and you go back to that kind of political thing slowly, we will begin to change people's minds where they go back to the days when they could make a separation between the party and the activists who is there working on the ground.
Well, let's hope that, you know, because I know that this question of local government is one that has been, apart from the national scenario, that local government has been on the agenda, and that is why we've had this limited bit of reform, and we have seen the kind of conflicts that would have arisen between, you know, the showbiz and the mayor in the towns and so on. But one of the things too that we need to do, and I said I'll ask Vincent to do that, because many people seem not to understand the difference, even people who you believe should, between Chapter 2801 and 2802, the Municipal and District the Councils Act, and the local government, that governs the NDCs and so on. And so they're mixing up the two in terms of the area of responsibility and the scope of responsibility, for instance, of chairman over the council and over the NDC as against the mayor in the city and mm-hmm. so on. So that is something that needs to be cleared up. And education is something that has to be.
You see, the Ministry of Social Cohesion should be doing a lot of that kind of civic education. Because one has to argue that people are entrenched in their ethnic identification. I don't see anything that is wrong with that. A lot of people say, well, you know, white people have to think ethnically and so on. They're mad. People will think ethnically is natural to do so, right? But I think if one is able to educate people that there is your ethnic identification, your group identification, and then there's a larger identification when the groups come together at the national level, and those two things are not competing with each other. I think where we have the problem is where ethnic groups feel that their identity and their security are in conflict with the national identity and the national conflict. And so therefore, you are going to have that pushback. So we have to create a national space, what I call the civic space, in which we are able to bring people into that space from different ethnic groups who can understand that you have this national space which is for everybody, but it doesn't threaten your ethnic space, right? Or it doesn't threaten your village space or your the space of your tongue and so on. And I think the Ministry of Social Cohesion, the Ministry of Education, should be teaching children those things in school. As a little boy in Buxton, I learned the history of Buxton in second standard, right? Kwesi and Kofi taught us the history of Buxton. By the time I get to fourth standard, we were going to the village office and going into the records. A man named Mr. Gill from Pleasance taught us at that time. And we would go in there and look for the records of the village, when, which year this was. So we had a sense beyond family and beyond your street that you were born, that there was something called Buxton that was larger than all of us. And there were Indians who lived in Buxton at the time, and who up to this day identify themselves as Buxtonians. And I'm sure this was the case in other villages across the country. So I think there should be space in the curriculum for people to learn about their country, to learn about their village. And so we develop different layers of identity. It is not just your ethnic identity, but it's your village identity. It's the identity, your county identity, Demerara, and so on. Your national identity. So that if people come to appreciate our various identities, and that these identities are not in conflict with each other, and it's not one or the other. You have to be an Indian, but and not a Guyanese, and if you're a Guyanese, you're not an Indian, and if you're an Indian, all that nonsense that people talk about, right? The beauty of any country in a modern world is its diversity. Diversity, of course, can be a killer, right? Mm-hmm. But if you educate people, right, you can close the gap between identity as a killer and identity as something that is beautiful and not ugly.
Okay, that's a point that we can depart on. But the fact that you talk about, I mean, East Indians from Buxton were proud to have been Buxtonians. I used to teach in Moore, and when I went there, I met lots of people, and they tell you, you know, me a Buxton man.
They're
willing.
Oh, yes.
To, yeah.
Oh, yes.
And
oh,
they
yes.
tell you all about their friends that they had there. And
yes, yes, yes,
and
yes.
And so on, you know.
Yes, we've got to exploit those
so
kinds
of
things.
The feeling of being part of that community is still
yes.
in them, even
yes.
though they had to move.
And go elsewhere.
That, right.
Uh-huh. And I do not believe that because an Indian person is an hardcore PNC, PPP person, that person cannot be socialized to see their other identities and to see how the Indianness intersect in a positive way with other people. You know, I they say that I'm Afrocentric and all that kind of stuff and so forth. And I don't know what Indian people say in their communities, but when I meet Indian people, I have this kind of conversation with them, and I feel that they relate to me as a fellow Guyanese. Now, I'm sure they don't share all of my politics, but I think the more people are in conversation, right? The more people talk, and this was the Rodney way. The more you engage in conversation, you become familiar with each other, and you come to understand that we share some of the same issues and we share some of the same problems, we come to better appreciate how our common action can help in this situation. Staying on the mountaintop and shouting, you know, let's all join hands and hearts together and be Guyanese, will get us nowhere, right? You have to engage people where they are. I just came from a funeral. An Indian friend of mine buried this morning, and I was at the funeral, and there were mostly East Indian people there. And a few of them came up to me and, began to talk and began to talk about what they see as what they call my capacity to reach beyond my government and all of that kind of stuff. So I think it's that kind of conversation that we need. Right? I would like to see us as Africans going into communities and having conversations with East Indians, and East Indians having conversations with us on the ground. Sometimes you have to keep these politicians out of the thing, because the sight of a politician sometimes send up people headache and get them, you know, all worked
thinking
up.
One way.
That's right. That's
this,
right.
This is not going to be in any way productive at the end.
Yes.
Right. Mm. All right. So, you mentioned the oil economy and preparation for that. What kind of preparation are you envisaging?
Well, I think first of all, it's a preparation to ensure that we get, as Guyanese, we get as much as possible from the oil. The experience of Trinidad, the experience of most oil countries, Nigeria, around the world, is that the oil is found in your country, but your country does not benefit in the long run from it, in the sense that the investors come in, whether it's Exxon or whoever else, and they're the ones who benefit mostly from the oil. And so as a national community, you are left with the crumbs.
That is the reason for Nigeria being in the position where the people are fighting to say that, well, look, I mean, we got all this oil here, but we ain't seeing any benefits.
That's right.
right?
And oil-rich country, but people poor.
Right.
Right? Venezuela, right? So, although Venezuela has done better than many countries under Chavez and so on. But so that's the first thing that we have to do to prepare, that we have to put our economic minds to work. No, I believe, Dion, that one thing that we have given the rest of the world, we in the Caribbean, is that we've given them educated people. We have given them brilliant minds. We have given them, I can't start to name them, but people from the Caribbean who are educated in the Caribbean and have made big impact on the world. Our own Walter Rodney, educated, little black boy from Bend Street, right? Educated here in Georgetown at Queen's College, but going on the world stage and really making a difference in terms of the way people think about development, the way people think about the world. And I still do think that we have a lot of brilliant minds here. You know, Clive Thomas is still very much around. Carl Greenidge is still very much around. And we can go on and call all those economists and political economists. I think we need to put those minds together. I don't like the term think tank. But we need to put them together someplace where they can begin to plan for an oil economy. What I'm hearing are ministers babbling, right, about oil. What do they know of oil who own the oil now, to paraphrase to paraphrase CLR James, right? I think that they should set up a small committee of people who are going to be able to think this thing through, but very importantly, who are going to be able to go and talk to people, because I think the ordinary people are going to be able to tell us a lot more about an oil economy than we can tell them. Right? So I think the first thing the government needs to do is to guard against the dividends from the oil going elsewhere and we don't benefit.
But one of the major things that we seem to be getting, the perception that we seem to be getting, is that the major focus of preparation is that, okay, we must train people to work in the oil sector. And we're not looking at the bigger picture of how, you know, we can garner from the production itself. So that they, as happened with Barama, as happened with Omai, as happened with this Chinese company that came, that all our resources are not taken out, and we end up getting nothing.
That's correct. So it's not just about training people to work in oil, but it's about making the linkages between oil and the local economy.
Well, that is my concern.
And that's your concern, and I have that very concern too. How does our transition into an oil economy benefit the farmer in Ansgrove or Ithaca or Denamstel or at Port Morant or at LBI, right? These are questions that we have to ask. How do we link that economy to the rest of the economy? You know, one of the mistakes we made when we made the transition to tourism in the wider Caribbean was that the hotels will be built by foreigners, the tourists will come from foreign, and the food they eat will come from foreign. There was no linkage between the tourist industry and the agriculture industry. So you go to any hotel in the Caribbean and the food they eat is coming from Miami, right? So what that means is that all the resources and all the quote-unquote profits,
we're basically financing a foreign economy.
A foreign economy. And that is something that we've got to pay attention to. And that's what I'm saying, put our minds to work and let them come up with that kind of blueprint so we know for sure where we're going. The third thing, and this is something people are not talking about, they're grumbling in behind. We live in a divided society, ethnically divided. The elites of one ethnic group or two ethnic groups are best placed to take advantage of the oil economy. And we have always had the problem of elite accumulation of wealth and the working people not being able to accumulate wealth. We've also had the problem of ethnic accumulation by one ethnic group or the other. We've got to look at that. So we've got to democratize our political economy so that all groups in the society are able to benefit from this wealth that is likely to be passing our way, all right? And this is a critical area because it has been one of the areas that we've grumbled about and we have never really confronted, all right? And certainly the PPP exacerbated the problem when it created a kind of new Indian Guyanese elite at the top there who have mega resources. A lot of these resources were resources that were granted to them by the state and so forth. So we have this imbalance that we have to correct at the level. Now, note I'm talking about elites, right? And I don't suggest that if you empower a black elite, it will be any better, right? So the democratization has to be at the level of the elites, but it has to also be at the level between those who are the top and those who are the bottom. So we have to change and probably legislate ways and means in which resources and wealth, if it come our way, can be evenly distributed among the various social groups in our society. That, I think, is a very urgent necessity.
We basically touched on this before, but in these companies that come, they're not new companies, they're massive companies, they're rich, and they are already established. Why is it that when they come to a country like Guyana, they want 3-5 years tax-free concessions, and aren't they able to ride the tide during that period when they are the initial phases of their investment? Why is it that they want all these concessions, and why is it that we grant them?
Right. They are able to ride the tide. They ask for those concessions because that is the law. The law of neoliberal economics is that, you know, they say business people take risks. And I always laugh. I would tell my students, do not believe that lie. If you want to take risks, you should do what you said. They don't take risks. They come in and they say, give us all these concessions. By giving them those concessions, you are guaranteeing them that they are not losing their investment. So this nonsense about investors being enterprising and taking risks, they do not take risks. They take advantage of the lack of leverage from small economies like us. If you have 50% unemployment among your young people, as we have, you're going to be glad if a fraction of those young people can be given employment. So when a company come and said, look, I can employ 1,000 people, that's 1,000 people that you are not able to find employment as a government, and so you are going to be willing to bend heels overhead in order to do that. And so, you know, historically, because we are post-plantation economies, you're talking about 50 years ago in 1966, moving from what was basically a plantation, planting and producing just sugar, to a modern economy that has to compete. You really can't do that unless you have imagination and you have luck, right? Barbados, for example, got luck, right? Barbados, you know, is far out in the Eastern Caribbean. It is not susceptible to hurricane as the other Eastern Caribbean countries. It had a settler whites who settled in Barbados, so it was our only settler economy, right? Because whites were there, education was introduced to the enslaved people earlier than they were. There were concessions granted by the Crown to Barbados because white people were there that they didn't grant to the other places. So Barbados was able to benefit from luck, right? Which the rest of us have not had, right? If this oil seems to be our luck, because I hear they say is probably the largest deposit in the world that they've found, right? Now, that's frightening for a place like Guyana, right? But it could be our luck. But you can get luck, but you have to manage the luck, right? What Barbados has shown is that at least you can manage the luck when it comes your way. And we in Guyana have to learn that. So, yes, we don't have to give them those concessions. But if your economy is down in the doldrums of Guyana's economy is in, then you have little bargaining chip with those people. And so therefore they come with their stated ideology, right? And you don't have leverage to push back against that. So you end up making these concessions. And that industrialization by invitation, which was tried since the 1950s, never really worked in the Caribbean. Jamaica tried it. Some of the other Eastern Caribbean countries tried it. It never worked because, one, the little wealth that was created stayed at the top among the elites who were brown and white. And secondly, the investors never came.
Okay.
Right? So this industrialization by invitation model has not really worked, right? It's the more the import substitution model, which was tried here by Mr. Burnham, tried by Michael Manley during democratic socialism, which is that you help to create your own business sector. So we have to begin to talk about manufacturing. How are we going to create manufacturing industries which can take that oil and turn them into other products and so on and so forth? That's where the economic strategy has to be. Do we have the leadership with that kind of ideological boldness? And I say ideological boldness, because that's the ideology of our time, is neoliberal economics and our ability to push back against neoliberal economics. And you push back at the level of policy, but you also push back at the level of ideas. Right? What alternative ideas you can put on the table so that we can push back against that. So it's about safeguarding Guyanese from being brutalized by a multinational corporation which has one objective, and that's to get as much profits as possible.
No, but we gotta also be concerned about the environment. One of the things that you find, for instance, the same Nigeria and in the Nile area and so on, the Delta area, where the people lived, where they farmed and all of these things, the entire place has been converted into a deadland because, you know, once oil gets into the earth, it becomes basically unproductive. And we have to be conscious of what is going to happen to our maritime resources, our, you know, our shoreline and all of these things once we get into the economy. And I don't know how prepared we are going to be for any eventualities in this regard.
We have had the experience of Omai, remember?
Yes, sir.
Right? Minor by big standards with oil, we face a bigger risk. Listen, the government, to their credit, they're talking about the green economy. The president is very big on the environment. And I think that's a very good thing because the presidential platform is what the Americans call a bully pulpit. And so I'm heartened by the fact that at least the head of the government is thinking in that direction. I don't know that we are taking all the necessary steps that are needed to make environmental consciousness not just something of the for intellectuals, but among the people themselves. You see, as we were talking earlier, when we were talking about the flood in the villages, it's about making the people themselves environmentally conscious. Because if the people are environmentally conscious, then you have a tidal wave to push back against the corporations. So when you say, listen, we have to make a balance here between development and the environment, you, the government, are not talking in isolation. You're talking with an environmentally literate country backing you up there. Because, you know, Professor Nekeford said, we are all we have, and we are all we have, the voices of our people, the energies of our people, the bodies of our people. And we've got to invest in our people, both in terms of developing the country, but in terms of defending the country against forces that, as David Rudder said, that don't need islands no more, right? Guyana and Jamaica and Trinidad and so on are no longer geopolitically strategic. Communism is gone, right? Castro is dead, right? That all we are worth now is exploiting our national resources. And so therefore, we have to mobilize our people to defend the country against plunder and so forth. It's a tall order, but we need our politicians to set the tone. Right, you are not going to defend your country against plunder as PPP, and as PNC, and AFC.
It has to be
and
a united.
It has to be a united national effort.
Okay, well, we just have to hope that, you know, people understand these things, because once the effects come, it doesn't affect any single individual. It affects across the board, and but I would hope. That any deals that we enter with these, you know, companies, that it's not a giveaway, it's not a sellout, because we've done that. By Shandling would have ripped this country off, you know, taking our logs out. They got into mining, they got into every, and they never made a cent that we could have, you know, that the economy itself could have really, except for the jobs, as you pointed out. Right, Barama the same thing.
Omai
the
same thing.
Same thing. I mean, and look at the tons of gold that Omai took out of there.
Yeah.
Right. And they never declare a profit.
That's right.
So something is wrong with with our politicians.
Yes.
Right. But the idea is, some people are saying that it's only the country that doesn't benefit, the politicians.
Well, yes, because corruption and graft, they're taking kickback from the people and so on, and you know, they oil in their pocket. And you know, I am very strong on this government. Let me say that, Dion. I'm very strong on this government. I've lived under the previous PNC government. It got worse under the PPP in terms of looking out for themselves and not the country, you know. The PNC, in the old PNC, you could have charged them again, you could have charged them for a lot of things.
Yeah.
But one of the things, they did not take corruption to the level at which the PPP took it. And I'm adamant that this government must break that cycle for the sake of Guyanese. At some point, somebody has to stand up, right? If it means that Mr. Granger will have to eclipse Jagannath Burnham as the leader who finally brought some kind of sanity to our politics, then he must do it. That's why I am adamant. They said that, you know, Hines want to bring down the government. No, I want to keep the government up. I want this government to take a very stern line against corruption. The president must read the riot act on his ministers. Don't wait till they start to become corrupt and then read the riot act. Read the riot act now, so that they are not tempted. We're hearing now about what? Some kind of thing with the IDB at the Ministry of Infrastructure.
And the Ministry of Health.
And the Ministry of Health. Now, if you came into power and in your first 3 months you put in place mechanisms to deal with corruption, you wouldn't be dealing with that today. Those who engage in that kind of thing would be frightened, because you would have had legislation and you would have had a government who would have declared zero tolerance.
Is
on
it President Mawana who's declared a the African president, is it not?
Which one? Is it in Uganda?
One of them that cut his minister's
salary. Yes. I'm trying to remember which country it is.
Right.
Yes.
And he's cleared, you know.
That's it.
Definitive.
Yes.
Once you're corrupt, you're out.
You're out. And I think Mr. Granger has to read that riot act.
Mm-hmm.
Don't wait until the situation get bad.
Okay. Because one of the complaints that we're hearing is that in too short a time, there are too many instances of, you know, people seeming to have already fit into this mode.
And some of the PSR holdovers from the PPP.
Right.
And when they look up and they see that the man up there is serious with this thing, I gonna continue to do my thing. It's human element, eh? And it's a culture. And the government has to come down strong on it.
Well, let's do hope that our president, you know, can find the strength and to make sure that, because remember, we still have to go back to the voting.
That's right.
At the end of the day, and if people feel despondent and all of these things, that what they have voted for is the same old thing,
mm-hmm.
Then they wouldn't want to
move. I have confidence in Granger to move in that direction. I think he's deliberate. He takes his time. He gets people like me a little mad sometimes, who want the thing to move quickly and so on. I understand that. But I want to tell him, move a little faster. Don't wait till you get close to 2020. Start. If you're walking slow, start trotting now.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Because time is not forever.
Mm.
All right. But thank you very much, Dr. Hines, for being here. To the people out there, do look forward to, Dr. Hines is next week.
Well, I may be back next week, depending on my availability.
All right. So do look out for us, and we continue to be with the Walter Rodney Grumlings as we keep you in tune with what is happening in Guyana and in other parts of the world. Do have a good night.